It's 5:37 p.m. There's a cold sweat on the back of your neck. You're standing at an ATM in a crowded grocery store. A few yards away, the cashier's drumming her long red nails on the counter next to your groceries. There's a long line of people waiting to pay. You turn back to the ATM and swipe your card for the third time. Nothing happens. Your card won't work. Behind you, someone in line lets out an exasperated sigh. You apologize to the cashier. Annoyed, you head back to your car, where you fish out your cell phone and give the bank a call. It takes three tries until a woman's voice finally answers. But it's just a recorded message, so garbled you can't make out a word. You hang up, start your engine. On the way home, you stop off at a gas station. The attendant comes out as usual, but before you can speak, he asks a strange question. You buying or selling? Confused, you tell him you just want to fill her up. But when you try to give him your credit card, he suddenly backs away. Sorry, we're closed, man, sorry. You sit there for a moment, wondering what has happened. Finally, you head home. You tell your wife what happened? Definitely strange. But she figures it's probably just a computer problem at the bank. They'll have it sorted out by morning. You agree, but as you fall asleep later that night, you're not so sure. Suddenly, it's 4 a.m., and there's a cold fear deep in the pit of your stomach. Something doesn't feel right. It's not just a computer problem, and you know it. First thing next morning, you take a trip to the bank. It doesn't look open. A piece of paper taped to one of the doors tells you that it's been closed temporarily. No explanation, just a phone number to call, and what looks like a government logo, but not one you recognize. You give the number a shot. It's that garbled message again. You hang up. Around the side of the building, there are a couple of dented ATMs with broken screens. As you head back to your car, you notice a man kneeling down by a pickup truck parked nearby. He's got a hose running from the truck's gas tank into a jerry can. Suddenly, he looks up and catches you staring at him. The look in his eyes tells you not to linger. He watches as you get in your car and drive off. Everything's closed. It's that same piece of paper everywhere, the same dark screens on every ATM. You start running into other desperate people, trying to deposit Social Security checks, take out cash, or find out why their cards suddenly aren't working. This is not just a problem with your bank. Your whole town is essentially shut down. And now, that fear, that cold fear comes back. Something is very, very wrong. Credit cards aren't working anywhere. Most stores and gas stations are closed. Those that are still open have cash only signs on their doors. That's a big problem because you don't have much cash left. There's some talk of a cyber attack. One analyst says banks have failed. Another says there's a run on cash, whatever that means. Still another is talking about a computer glitch. You don't know what to think. The sun is starting to set. There's a black helicopter skimming along the horizon. And now it's here, whatever it is. As you stare into the coming night, you wonder how long the food in the pantry will last, and what you might have to do if this doesn't get resolved quickly. Hi, my name is Bill Bonner. You may not know me, but I'm the president of Agora Incorporated, the largest underground news and research network in the world. I started this company in 1979, and today we're actually bigger than the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal put together. But almost nobody knows my name. And there's a reason for that. I'll explain it later. First, I want to tell you that I recognize that what I'm about to show you is so remarkable that you're not likely to believe me. It's so shocking that I know the burden is on me to prove it to you, and that's what I'm going to do. And I hope, if nothing else, even if I haven't 100% convinced you, I hope you'll remember this warning. And when the crisis hits, at least you'll recognize what is going on, and you'll know what to do. The information I'm about to share with you has never been released to the general public before. You see, right now, at this very moment, the highest levels of our government are locked in a desperate last stand against an inevitable crisis, one you would never expect or even think possible. Our leaders have already spent $4.5 trillion, more than we spent on World War II, trying to contain this problem, and they're going to lose this fight. In fact, when they do, and believe me, they will, a systemic shock will disrupt our lives in ways you never thought possible. You will suddenly be locked out of your own bank account, unable to withdraw cash or deposit a check. Your stocks will swing wildly out of control. You won't even be able to access your Social Security money. Like a virus, it will spread to our food supply chain, causing massive shortages in the cities and suburbs. The same will happen to our gas network. America's highways will become empty and quiet. And one by one, every service you've come to depend on, from your bank to your grocery store, to our federal government, will shut down. You won't be able to get cash, and without cash, you won't be able to buy food or gasoline. I realize that must sound outrageous, but I hope to show you I'm simply following a massive amount of research on this subject to its logical conclusion. I'm sure you're also more than a bit skeptical about me. After all, you've probably never heard of Agora before or of me. We don't own a cable channel or a single newspaper. We don't buy splashy ads in magazines. We don't sponsor sports stadiums or anything like that. We keep a low profile. Despite our size, we operate very privately, and we only share our research and news directly with our private subscribers. Yet in our 36 years, we've grown into the biggest firm of our kind on the planet, operating across 20 different countries with 2.4 million subscribers worldwide. And we've done it by exposing and often predicting the most important events and trends in recent world history. For example, on March 10, 2000, I personally warned that a day of reckoning was close at hand for the dot-com bubble. Starting that very day, the NASDAQ began a two-year 77% plunge. That same year, we issued our trade of the decade: buy gold, sell U.S. stocks. 10 years later, the media pronounced gold the best investment of the 2000s. Gold went on a 571% tear. Stocks fell 24%. On March 31, 2005, we warned that housing, along with lenders Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, would collapse. We reported, and I quote, "Something is smoldering in the mortgage lending market, and the heart of fire is on the balance sheet of Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae." On October the 2nd, 2009, we alerted our readers that America was around the corner from a huge oil boom. Over the next few years, oil production in some parts of America soared 300% to 393%. How could we predict these things? If you were to walk into one of Agora's 33 offices, you'd be just as likely to meet a banker as you would a classical scholar or a surgeon or even the former head of the BBC. We employ smart, curious men and women with a contrarian streak who aren't afraid to question the mainstream media and the status quo. That's how we've been able to predict some of the most important major world events, often long before these events occurred. Go back 30 years. What were the big, big events that happened during that period? Fall of the Soviet Union in 1989? The crash of the dot-com boom in 2000? The rise of violence in the Muslim world? The bubble in finance and housing, and the blow-up that came in 2008? Then the recovery that didn't happen afterwards. I'm proud to say that our analysts saw every one of these things coming. As far as I know, we were the only ones who got them all right. Yes, we were often too early. In 1993, we predicted the rise of Islamic terrorism. We wrote back then, "Especially troubling for many in the West will be the rise of Islam. This could be the biggest threat to world peace in the next two decades. The bomb at the New York's World Trade Center is just a small taste of what is to come." In December 1994, we exposed an IRS plan to tax Americans who gave up their citizenship. We said, "Reliable sources tell us that IRS staff are preparing the groundwork to impose an exit tax on Americans." In 1996, the tax appeared in the U.S. Congress. Bill Clinton signed it into law. But let me stop here for a moment. Because although our track record, so far, is unmatched, we've even bested the CIA more than once, the past is not what brought me here today. I mention our success only because I need you to understand that we take what we do very seriously. We are a company that focuses on ideas and trends. Our aim is to promote ideas that we think will make the world a better place, and expose ideas that we think are false and dangerous. And that's exactly why I've put together this research piece today. I want to expose a very dangerous idea that has become wildly popular, not only in America, but around the globe. It's an idea that is going to cause the biggest explosion in America in our lifetimes. I hope you'll listen to my analysis, and if you agree with my conclusion, I hope you'll take action. Don't worry, I'm not running for office or seeking political donations, and everything I'm offering you here, you can get for free. My goal here is not to convince you that there's something wrong with this country or scare you with some story about an international conspiracy. It's not that simple, and it's not that easy to fix. Instead, I'm just going to tell you what I think is really going on. It's something so big, so dangerous, and frankly so unavoidable that you really must be prepared. Specifically, our highest levels of government are locked in a desperate struggle to patch up a fatal flaw in the U.S. economy. It's one that my company, Agora, first warned about in 1993, one that I've personally been tracking for over 40 years. Hard to believe, I know. But that's just what makes this thing so remarkable and so dangerous. I quote, "Literally, your ATM wouldn't work. You type in your code, no money comes out. You get your paycheck, you can't cash it." Those are not my words. Those are the words of the architect of the 2008 bank bailouts, Treasury Department insider Neil Kashkari. If what he's describing sounds similar to the scenario I started this presentation with, there's a good reason. Every part of that scenario was based on an actual event that we came very close to a few years ago, and a threat that our government has been forced to admit is all too real. Former Secretary of the Treasury Tim Geithner has stated, "We came exceptionally close. You could hear the fear and the panic. Because anybody living in that world at that time, running a business at that time, knew that they were on the edge of losing the capacity to function." This has been confirmed by former Secretary of the Treasury Hank Paulson, as well as two U.S. congressmen. And while President Obama assured Americans that, quote, "the shadow of the crisis has passed" in his last State of the Union address, I recently came across video footage of Janet Yellen, the current chairwoman of the Federal Reserve, openly admitting that the U.S. is facing a very real threat. We could find ourselves in a devastating spiral. That's a quote from Janet Yellen. She goes on to assure everyone that the Federal Reserve is fully in control of the situation. But the truth is that by their own standards, the Fed's policies have not worked. And as I'm going to show you, the economic situation in this country is spinning out of control very quickly. As I write, the U.S. economy is shrinking. This is despite the biggest stimulus of new cash and credit in history. We have fewer real breadwinner jobs today than we did 15 years ago. And the typical household has less income. But let me back up for a second and explain exactly what it is we're facing and how we got here in the first place. By now, I'll bet you've already heard more than a few over-the-top conspiracies and wacky theories from people who don't have all the facts. Maybe you've even watched a few specific dates for the beginning of a crisis come and go. If so, you're not alone. There are a lot of people out there who know deep down that something's not right in America, that it's been a different place since 2008. Yes, they can't quite put their finger on what exactly is happening or what's coming next, because it's not just Obama or the national debt or a currency threat. There's a much deeper problem. That's why the hundreds of internet experts you've probably heard from are usually wrong. They only point at the symptoms, not the real threat. Meanwhile, the mainstream media is almost completely ignoring the danger we're in. They just don't understand it. Between that and the official recovery story coming out of Washington, it's no small wonder that the vast majority of Americans still have no idea about the threat our own government is spending trillions of dollars trying to contain. But then, that's why my company, Agora, exists. That's what brings me here today, to tell you the truth as we see it. And the truth is that what's wrong with America didn't start in 2008, or in the decade before that. I first noticed it around 40 years ago. You see, the reason I'm here, the reason I'm doing something I've never done before in releasing a message like this to the general public, is that I'm just about the only one in the business, in fact, in the entire industry, who's been following this story from the very beginning. My involvement with this threat dates back to the 1970s. Back then, I was working in Washington, running one of the most important lobbying groups at the time, the National Taxpayers Union. I went to work in politics after college. That's how I wound up running NTU while attending law school at Georgetown at night. During that period, I attended Reagan's inaugural ball, I met Ron Paul, I gave Grover Norquist, head of the Americans for Tax Reform and one of the most powerful lobbyists in our country today, his first job in the city. I found myself having lunch with Margaret Thatcher and Milton Friedman at the same time. I'll never forget it. But frankly, I was never much for the glitz or the schmoozing. I never quite cared enough about partisan politics. I never believed enough in government programs to fit in with the Beltway crowd. I mention my D.C. years because during that time, I made my first attempt to stop the disaster I see coming. I became involved in an effort to get every state in the Union to ratify a balanced budget amendment to the U.S. Constitution. The New York Times from March 6, 1981, describes the story. The drive to propose a constitutional amendment requiring the federal budget to be balanced has started up again. The National Taxpayers Union, leading the effort nationally, said it believed that four more states could be found to pass the proposal this year. That effort came to a halt when Ronald Reagan was elected. People thought we didn't need a balanced budget amendment. I thought so too for a while. Then when I realized that the Republicans were spending and borrowing even more than the Democrats, I made another attempt to stop them. Along with my 7-year-old son, I sued the federal government. I argued that federal debt was unconstitutional because the young would pay for government spending without ever getting a chance to vote on it. That suit lost too. But the problem I'm warning you about today is not the national debt. And I'm not warning you about inflation or that the dollar will lose purchasing power. Those things will happen too. But the real threat is much different, and it's much, much more dangerous. Don't get me wrong. I still think it's an important issue, and one we've been deeply involved with at Agora. For example, our documentary on the subject, IOUSA, which includes interviews with Warren Buffett, Alan Greenspan, my friend Ron Paul, me, and others, was screened at the Sundance Film Festival and widely praised by critics. In fact, after seeing the film, Roger Ebert made it one of his top 5 documentary films of that year, writing, "A Letter to Our Grandchildren." I have just seen a documentary titled IOUSA that snapped into sharp focus why your lives may not be as pleasant as ours. But while I recognize just how dangerous a broke government can be, and how much damage large government deficits have done to other nations, I've since realized that the government's debt is really just a symptom of the disease itself. In short, our national debt is actually a smaller part of a much larger and much more dangerous threat. Here's the real problem. There's no official record of this, but I estimate that somewhere between $958 billion to $1.5 trillion changes hands in the U.S. every month. People buy milk, pay babysitters, they pay their mortgages and their taxes. Consumer spending alone is $11.2 trillion annually. But here's the thing, there's only $1.2 trillion worth of actual dollars, physical money, in the entire world. We can't be sure how much of that is actually here in the U.S. Estimates hold that some 50% to 75% of our money is in overseas bank accounts or held by foreign governments. And a lot of what is left in the States is called dead money. It's stuffed in mattresses and safety deposit boxes. In fact, the amount of U.S. dollars being hoarded this way, that is to say, the amount of dead money, is now at an all-time high. All in all, there might be as little as $250 billion actual U.S. dollars circulating in the United States. And while that might seem like a lot of money, consider that a single U.S. company, Walmart, takes in nearly twice that amount in annual revenue. And our government spends 14 times that amount in just a year. So if there are only $250 billion physical U.S. dollars in this country, where are all those trillions of dollars coming from? And what would happen if they suddenly disappeared? Let me remind you that those physical U.S. dollars are America's only legal money or tender. There is no digital dollar, at least not yet. And the average Joe isn't buying his groceries with Bitcoin. One explanation is that people are just spending the same dollars over and over, so that $250 billion is changing hands so much that you see trillions of dollars spent at the end of the year. Only that can't be possible. What I've just described is called monetary velocity, and you can measure it. And right now, monetary velocity is at its lowest point in history. People aren't spending that $250 billion in actual U.S. dollars. It's staying put in those mattresses and safety deposit boxes. So people are spending something else. And here it is, the terrifying source of all our money. It's our credit system. As you can see, for the past 30 or so years, it's been growing exponentially. That's why, although wages have been falling since the 1970s, and although we have fewer dollars to spend, and our dollars are worth less and less, America still appears to be getting richer and richer. Since the 1970s, the credit system in America has grown to become our biggest and our most crucial asset. Credit, not real money, what people spend. it's more than twice the value of every single home in America put together. More than three times the value of every single U.S. bank's assets combined. More than 20 times the trillions of dollars the U.S. government collects in taxes every year. But it's also our biggest liability. If you have a dollar, it's yours. It doesn't matter what other people think or what's happening on Wall Street. It's yours to spend as you like. But credit is different. It can disappear before you spend it. Because at some point, all that credit can only exist if people believe they'll get paid back. That is, if they believe there's enough money in America to pay back all that $60 trillion in outstanding credit. But here's the truth. There isn't. Our credit system is insolvent. And when it fails, which it surely will do, it could wipe out more wealth than any other crisis in history. To put that in context, $10.2 trillion vanished during the financial meltdown of 2008. This crisis will wipe out six times that amount. I'm not talking about a few credit cards getting denied. I'm talking about the whole system shutting down. In modern America, long, complex chains of production and distribution put food on your table and gas in your car. 8 out of 10 people live in cities or suburbs. Almost no one, not even the farmers themselves, can survive off of food they grow themselves. Instead, they all depend on credit. First, the farmer gets a loan from the bank to buy his farm. Then he uses credit to buy supplies, fuels, fertilizer, seed, everything. After the crops are sown, the wholesaler, who got a loan to build his warehouse and processing center, uses credit to buy the raw food from the farmer so he can process it and package it. Then a trucker, who got an auto loan to buy his truck, uses credit to buy fuel so he can haul the food to a retailer. The retailer needs credit to keep the lights on and the shelves stocked and the stores open. Each part of this chain can afford to take on that debt because they know that eventually the consumer will buy that food, most likely using a credit card. If any one crucial piece of that chain stops working, suddenly suburbs and cities are cut off from their food supplies. Businesses can't run. Paychecks don't go out. When the credit system starts to implode, it not only destroys the mechanism that runs our economy, it shuts down our access to our own money. Imagine what happens as lenders try to redeem $50 trillion worth of credit, and there's only $250 billion to go around. You go to your ATM, you ask for cash, but there isn't any cash left. Suppose you have a 10,000 line of credit on your card. If the credit system doesn't work, you might as well be flat broke. Dollars become ultra scarce. Prices skyrocket. Banks go under. In fact, it would only take about 3 hours for our entire country to shut down. I know that must sound impossible, but I know this for a fact. You see, the last time our credit system came to the verge of collapse, that's exactly what nearly happened. I know, I was watching. So was my whole network of analysts and researchers all over the globe. I quote, "Tonight, I want you to go to the ATM machine, and I want you to draw out everything it will let you take." That's a quote from Senator Richard Burr, North Carolina, chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee. On Friday, in 2008, he called his wife, Brooke, to tell her that he wasn't coming home that weekend. He had urgent business in D.C. He also gave her one very important instruction. Go to an ATM, take out everything you can. Out in California, the CEO of PIMCO, the largest mutual fund in the world, was telling his wife the same thing. It's a quote. "I said, just go to the ATM. I'm not sure the banks are going to open tomorrow." And she said to me, "You must be kidding." I said, "No." I'll bet that sounds extreme, but What you may not know is at the time, the U.S. was just hours away from a total systemic shock. At 11 a.m., the Federal Reserve had noticed hundreds of billions of dollars starting to disappear from the American economy. A massive loss of faith in the system had prompted big players to get their money out while they still could. In response, the government began injecting billions to, quote, liquefy the system. And it watched helplessly as that money vanished without a trace. Congressman Paul Kanjorski remembers panicked meetings with Secretary of the Treasury Hank Paulson and Chairman of the Federal Reserve Ben Bernanke behind closed doors in Washington that day. He would later admit that if not for one last-ditch effort, the entire United States of America would have gone dead in the water by 2 p.m. that afternoon. Shocking, I know. Especially because most people still don't realize how close we came to a full-scale shutdown, or how close we are still. You see, this situation never actually got resolved. Instead, it got worse. A McKinsey study tells us that there's $57 trillion more debt today than there was in 2007, and it's growing. In fact, it's being artificially pumped up by the Federal Reserve and other central banks. As you can see from the chart above, our current credit system started around 1950. In the late 70s, traditional American industries such as cars, steel, televisions, radios, even computers moved overseas. Credit came in and replaced traditional wage increases as a way to prop up our economy. That's what triggered the massive growth phase it entered around that time. Agora warned in 1993 that it would begin to unwind, that the credit cycle would come to an end. That nearly happened in 2000, when the credit system first stalled out and the dot-coms went bust. But then, housing was there to support it. All that credit rushed into the housing market, which then shot up to meteoric levels. But when housing collapsed, there was nothing else to keep us going. That's when the Federal Reserve started buying up bonds and mortgages. Starting with a balance sheet of $700 billion before the crisis, the Federal Reserve is now on the hook for $4.5 trillion. That's how much new cash and credit it has put into the system in the last 6 years. Our lender of last resort, the Federal Reserve, has become too big to fail. Unfortunately, if it does, there's no higher entity that can step in, save our credit system. It has simply gotten too big. And all it takes is just one small loss of faith. A few big players start taking their money out while they still can. And then people start lining up at ATMs. And a systemic shock will paralyze the nation. Even former Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan is sounding the alarm. Unless we come to grips with this problem, I'm afraid we're going to run into some kind of political crisis. In the 36 years Agora has been providing its subscribers with information, we've seen countries get hit with financial shocks like this again and again. In just the last century, I can name at least 38 events very similar to what I'm describing. But none of them has even come close to the scale of a potential collapse here in America. That's because none of these countries has ever been able to borrow so much or become so dependent on credit. We're going to see just how dependent we've become, and I'm not looking forward to it. America's unique status as the world's superpower has enabled us to keep borrowing at unheard-of levels. All on the assumption that we're good for it. But we're not. And at some point, someone will realize that. When Americans can no longer use their credit cards, when grocery stores are hoarding food rather than selling it, when we become stranded in our homes because there's no gasoline, when our retirements vanish, when our government benefits are cut off, what will happen to America as a country? I'd like to be able to say that we'll band together and take care of each other, but will we? In the 1970s, we had a near miss with a very similar kind of crisis. Our steel and auto industries began to fail. Gas prices soared. Riots broke out in major cities like Philadelphia, Boston, and Chicago. One woman, a teenager at the time, remembers. Working at a country gas station, she remembers being swarmed by an angry mob one day after the gas station ran out of gas. In terms of economic crisis, it was tiny compared to what we're facing today. Yet, it shook America to its very foundation. Can you imagine a full-blown collapse in today's America? Where anger at police is reaching a boiling point? Where teenagers can use the internet to summon flash mobs in just minutes? Where half the population pays no taxes and depends on aid from the federal government? Where students, crippled by college loans, can't get jobs? Given what we just saw in Baltimore and in Ferguson, New York, Oakland, and other cities last fall, with people seizing just about any excuse to loot stores and break windows, how long do you think those same people will refrain from stealing and violence when they can't get a meal? My feeling is not very long. All this must seem incredible, but I've seen these types of crises play out again and again all over the world. Because of the nature of my business, I've lived on 3 continents and visited probably 100 countries. I was an economic advisor to Belarus in 1992, just before a crisis turned the country into a socialist dictatorship. I recommended that they establish a firm system of private property rights, auction off state-owned property, and let the free market do the rest. But the Soviet-era bosses who controlled the country weren't willing to let go their own power. They chose an opposite course. A few years later, I witnessed one of the most powerful rivals undergo a similar collapse. People desperately tried to find cash as ATMs went dark. Debit cards stopped working, and banks shuttered and disappeared altogether. Millions of seniors were cut off from their pensions without warning. The government made it illegal to withdraw money from your own bank account. They shut down the stock market after it plummeted 10% in 40 minutes. People couldn't get rid of their investments for any price. Flour, butter, rice, and sugar disappeared. Hospitals ran out of medicine. Elderly women were forced to dig through trash bins for food. The situation grew so severe that the government organized a special SWAT team to conduct tax raids on the homes of its citizens to get every last dime it could out of them. And I'm not talking about ancient history either. This happened in 1999. And there are plenty more examples where that came from. For instance, most people think of Argentina as a poor country. What they don't know is that before America became the dominant superpower on the planet, Argentina was one of her main competitors. It was a lot like the U.S., with similar resources, a similar population, and similar spirit of free enterprise and liberty. In fact, Argentina was actually growing faster than America. Buenos Aires, its capital, was settled by immigrants from Ireland, Italy, and Germany. It combined the rich agriculture and industry of Chicago with the boulevards, parks, and buildings of Paris. A few years ago, I bought an isolated cattle ranch up in the Andes Mountains of South America. So I pass through Buenos Aires regularly on my way there, and I know the country pretty well. Walking down the streets, you'll see decaying subway trains, state of the art many years ago. Big, beautiful buildings covered in graffiti, windows broken, old cars, top of the line in their day, sitting junked by the side of the road. It's as if a war had broken out. Why? It was a financial crisis, very similar to what I see coming in the U.S. In fact, when you look at the damage that events like this can cause, it's no small wonder our government has already put $4.5 trillion, that is more than it cost to liberate Europe, towards stopping it. For example, in the 1990s, riots killed 1,500 people and destroyed 4,000 buildings when a country in Asia got hit with a similar economic disaster. But worse than the property damage, the violence, even the food shortages, events like this have a strange power, greater even than wide-scale physical disaster, a power to not only make your wealth and the stability you've grown accustomed to disappear, but also your very way of life, the traditions, the values, things passed down for generations. For example, when a violent monetary trauma hit Germany's First Republic, thousands of years of tradition disappeared overnight. Worse than the financial damage was the social damage. Families collapsed as the young turned on the old. Women were forced into prostitution. Mothers begged to keep their children fed. Political gangs assassinated one another in the streets. A young man recalls, "It was dreadful to watch. It was more than disorder that smashed over people. It was something like daily explosions. If anything survived one explosion, it got into another the next day." Another writer, Kurt Kirsten, recorded the downfall as it happened. "German culture, as much as it existed, is perishing. The middle class is worn out. One has only two choices, either slowly perish or join the left-wing revolutionary party." Imagine that in today's America, when our very culture is already under attack, where the young already seem to be at war with our traditions. Imagine for a second, truckers can't get the gas they need for their rigs, grocery stores' shelves start to go bare, homeowners can't get loans, and prices crash, bonds become worthless, IRAs and 401ks can't be cashed out, stocks fall dramatically before the markets close altogether. Prices swing wildly out of control. People take to the streets, demanding action from the government. Strikes paralyze our industries. Rioting destroys homes, shops, even entire neighborhoods. I'm not saying you'll wake up tomorrow and suddenly America will no longer be a superpower, or that tonight someone will try to kick down your door looking for cash and valuables. But what I am saying is that when this does start, things will go bad very quickly. You never think it'll happen to you. In fact, no one ever does. It's human nature. Your brain actually won't let you believe that a disaster can happen. Even when the evidence is clear that a major upheaval is on its way, even when it's a simple matter of common sense that danger is near, most people convince themselves that it can't happen. Look, how many big events have happened in the last 30 years? I can only think of five. The collapse of the Japanese miracle economy, fall of the Soviet Union, the blow-up of the dot-com bubble, the attack on the World Trade Center and the War on Terror, and the financial crisis of 2008-2009. I'm proud to say that my organization got 4 out of 5 of these things right. I don't know of anyone else who was even close. But that's how big events happen and why they're so important, because nobody expects them. For instance, back in the late 1980s, I became convinced that the Japanese stock market was about to crash. At that time, the Japanese had just bought New York City's Rockefeller Center for $846 million. They had also bought Columbia Pictures for $4.4 billion. An American tire maker, Firestone, was also, suddenly, a Japanese company. They were selling more cars than we were. They were making better computers and TVs. On the face of it, it was crazy to bet against them. Yet on page 87 of our annual forecast of 1989, we wrote, "In our view, the Japanese stock market is one of the two most overvalued markets in the world. The long-running bull market in Tokyo may be nearing an end." That year, the Japanese stock market was at its highest point in history. Movies and books at the time were depicting a future with Japan as the number one superpower. Maybe that sounds foolish now, but back then it was a fact. And everyone thought we were crazy for predicting the end of Japanese domination. I remember, in October of that year, one of my friends, economist and author, Mark Skousen, made a joke of it. As a present, he gave me a mock-up of a book, How I Called the Crash in Japan by Bill Bonner. I wish I had written that book. 2 months later, the Japanese stock market began a decline that is still going on today, as Japan entered what would later be called the lost decade. People just refused to believe that big change was on the way and that Japan would fizzle out. At Agora, we've run into that many times. For example, in 1987, we predicted the fall of the Soviet Union. Back then, we wrote, "The same hidden megapolitical forces of decentralization that broke up the European empires are doing their work. The Soviet empire will inevitably crack apart." At the time, our politicians in Washington had been stockpiling weapons to guard against what they thought was superior Soviet technology. The famous Team B report commissioned by the CIA years earlier had claimed that the Soviet economy was booming, that they were capable of mass-producing bombers and missiles, and that they wouldn't hesitate to attack America. Yet in 1987, we weren't fooled. We wrote, "We have no doubt that sooner or later, but probably sooner, many of the characteristic features of the Soviet system will be abandoned." Put it simply, communism is in its twilight. Sure enough, 2 years later, the empire started to break apart. By 1991, it was all over. Something scholars and politicians here in the U.S. had been unwilling to believe. Even a report commissioned by the CIA and approved by George H.W. Bush got it totally wrong. People just could not imagine that a world superpower would suddenly become irrelevant. Just as people could not believe that Japan would ever break down, or that the tech boom would ever stop, or that housing prices would fall. As I've said before, Agora has been at the forefront of nearly every great world event in the past 30 years, and even the government has acknowledged it. After 9/11, the CIA requested copies of a note I had sent subscribers warning of trouble ahead for America. But that was the one even we didn't see coming. And years before that, the CIA actually tried to convince me to use Agora as a front for their international operations. In case you're wondering, I said no. Yet despite all that, we've encountered the same resistance each and every time we release new research. In fact, we've studied it. And there's a good reason human beings often refuse to believe that things can change. I'm from Southern Maryland. I grew up in a poor family, and as soon as school let out, we'd go to work in the tobacco fields. This was in the 1950s and 60s, back when that sort of thing was still allowed. Every year, in mid-spring, my Uncle Edward would get my cousin, my brother, and me to sit on the back of his old tractor and plant tobacco while he drove up and down the fields. Now, imagine that my uncle wasn't sure summer would come that year, that he wasn't sure the tobacco crop would grow. Well, I can tell you, Uncle Edward would have sat on his porch with a six-pack instead. You see, human beings need to believe that things will happen more or less as they always have, that the sun will come up every morning, that plants will grow, that the rains will come. If we didn't, we couldn't plant food or buy houses or start businesses or do much of anything. Of course, believing nothing will ever change is actually a form of delusion. Totally irrational. But it's necessary for our survival. The problem, though, is that sometimes things do change, big time, and we are unprepared when really big changes are about to strike. People refuse to believe what's often right in front of them. Lawyers call this willful blindness. Psychologists call it the normalcy bias. That's why, while I was warning our subscribers about the dot-com bubble, for example, plenty of people thought it would never end. A famous book at the time, Dow 36,000, argued that the stock market was cheaper than ever. An article published in The Atlantic read, "Stock prices could double, triple, or even quadruple tomorrow and still not be too high." Then suddenly the Nasdaq started falling and eventually wiped out 77% of its value. Today, I'm seeing the same willful blindness here in America. People believe that our credit economy can just keep going forever, that we can keep borrowing and spending money that really isn't there. They think debt can go up faster than income indefinitely, even though it's mathematically impossible. And now, our highest government officials are still locked in a desperate struggle to keep this system going. And the fact of the matter is, they've already used up all the tools they have. They've kept credit cheap by reducing interest rates to near zero. How much lower can they put the rate if the system runs into trouble? They've already expanded the Fed's balance sheet by 542% in just a few years. How much more can they do? History is full of people who thought they were the exception, just like most Americans believe today. These stories always play out the same way. People think the rules don't apply to them. They think they can get away with something that no one else has. Our credit economy is no different. The rules still apply. Credit is not real money. It's just the flip side of debt. You run up too much debt, and you go broke. And many, many Americans are about to learn this eternal truth the hard way. We can't build the biggest credit system in world history and expect it to stay standing forever. Eventually, someone loses faith. In fact, we've seen this before right here in America. In 1819, people in America started noticing that banks were always trying to get out of honoring cash deposits. They'd give you an IOU instead, supposedly as good as real money. But attempts to redeem those notes for actual money were actually blocked or stalled in some way. Suddenly, cash started to skyrocket in value, with banks desperately trying to cover up the fact that they couldn't actually honor their deposits. They didn't have enough money. When the American public, along with foreign creditors, caught on to this, a third of America's money vanished into a black hole. The Western territories ran out of cash completely. They had to switch to a barter system using grain. Real estate and land prices dropped off a cliff, as did income from rents. You couldn't sell anything because no one had the money to buy it from you. And no one would risk a loan because there wasn't necessarily enough cash to get it back. Nearly half of all the money in the country disappeared. The resulting economic collapse stretched on well into the following decade. And we were lucky, because we were young. And the collapse happened before the problem was bad enough to do permanent damage. And back then, most families were self-sufficient, and the whole economy worked on cash, not credit. Today, it's a different story. We have a credit system worth more on paper than the national wealth of most countries, and it's already starting to come apart. Ever since that 2008 morning, when the Treasury noticed billions disappearing from the U.S. economy, the Federal Reserve has been locked in a desperate struggle to keep this event at bay, and it hasn't worked. They've even been flooding the U.S. economy with more new money than ever to try to make up the shortfall. You see, the Fed's goal is to hit 2% inflation. When that happens, they'll know what they're doing is working. Except inflation won't budge. They're already doing everything they can, and now they're running out of time. By this summer, the Federal Reserve was already supposed to be raising interest rates, but the latest GDP numbers show the economy is contracting, not growing. Now, the consensus is that they will keep rates low, at least till the fall. And frankly, I don't believe they'll raise rates then either, because we're starting to see dollars being drained from investment funds. In just 1 week, $7.2 billion disappeared from U.S. stock funds, the ninth major withdrawal in the last 10 weeks. Just one fund has already seen $38 billion pulled out this year. To compare, the previous record for withdrawals was set in 2009, was just $20 billion. And Wall Street's already on edge. A note from a Bank of America analyst is now warning, correction risk will grow in the absence of fresh inflows in the coming weeks. It's not clear where this money is going, but billionaires are thought to be hoarding an average of around $600 million in cash each. That's what happens, by the way. The smart money heads for the exits first. Then there's a panic. What is clear is that cash dollars are already skyrocketing in value. As we get closer and closer to this crisis, I expect more and more restrictions on your ability to deposit, to withdraw, and to use your own cash. Here's what will happen. You'll go to your ATM, but your account will be frozen. The bank will tell you it noticed a suspicious activity. What suspicious activity? You tried to take out your cash. In fact, we're already seeing this in Europe. Just recently, a Swiss pension fund tried to withdraw a very large amount of cash from its bank. with the idea of storing that cash in a guarded vault instead. The bank refused to give the fund its money. And when the pension fund complained, the government backed the bank. In fact, it admitted that it had been, quote, recommending that banks with cash demands act restrictively. And it's already starting to happen in the U.S. The U.S. government has started implementing public law 111147, which makes it harder for Americans to take money out of the United States and out of American banks. Banks like J.P. Morgan are no longer allowing people to store cash in safety deposit boxes. In certain American cities, Chase Bank customers are now not allowed to make cash payments on credit cards, mortgages, equity lines, and auto loans. In fact, a man who tried to pay his mortgage with cash at a Bank of America was nearly arrested. And when a reporter from the liberal Daily Kos tried to investigate, he was accused of casing the bank. From Florida to New York, states have been moving to restrict citizens from accessing and using cash. In fact, Louisiana just made it illegal to use cash to buy any precious metals, including gold. Even some in the mainstream media have started to notice what's going on. Bloomberg has reported, there's a surge of creativity around ways to drive interest rates deeper into negative territory. As this new world takes shape, cash becomes pivotal. Am I just being paranoid? Well, I hope so. Maybe it won't happen. Maybe it won't be so bad. But as you'll see in a moment, something must give. The credit economy cannot last, and it's anyone's guess just how bad it will be when it finally gives way. In America today, we're seeing protest, rioting, young people fighting with police and turning their backs on American values. A majority of people in the U.S. now favor taking some people's money to distribute to others. A majority also favor higher taxes. It's already beginning to look like a very different America from the one you and I grew up in. Today, 1 in 5 Americans do not think the U.S. will remain a single country going forward. There have already been secession movements in Texas and now in Hawaii. In fact, a consultant for the Pentagon recently revealed plans by the Chinese to provide arms to these Hawaiian separatists. And Chinese officials have actually threatened the U.S. Secretary of State, saying they would not hesitate to assert their territorial claims over the islands. According to at least one source, the U.S. military even has contingency plans in place for the withdrawal of U.S. troops from Hawaii. Meanwhile, a recent report by Pew Research finds Americans more divided than ever. But frankly, you don't need a scientific study to prove that. From the violence that ripped through Baltimore last April, to the complete dysfunction of our Congress, to the massive decline in marriage rates for our young men and women, to the increasingly vocal and sometimes violent opposition to traditional American values, I'm not sure how well America, at least as I know it, could withstand food shortages, banks closings, bonds, retirement accounts, and benefits becoming worthless. That's what would happen, because there's not enough real money, real cash, to support the standard of living that we're used to. Realize that if you collected every single dollar in the country, you'd have less money than the GDP of Finland, and not much more than the GDP of Greece. Our economy runs on credit, not cash. And in a credit crisis, which is certainly ahead, credit is the first thing to disappear. The second thing that goes is cash. And then you have real problems. I've seen cases where economic shocks like this last years, where people are cut off from their bank accounts for months at a time, where prices swing wildly out of control, where strikes cripple services and shut down highways, where hospitals can't get medicine, where governments become increasingly desperate and violent. Whether this will happen today or tomorrow or a month from now, I don't know. Nobody knows. But I do know that no country in history has ever maintained the course that America is on now. I know that no one gets away with creating fake wealth. Credit can't be free. There's always a price to pay. Many of my closest friends and colleagues, some of the richest, most well-connected people I know, are already preparing themselves Some are buying gold and silver, some are moving to foreign countries or even renouncing their U.S. citizenship. All of them are stashing away cash. Pretty extreme, I know. Myself? I already mentioned my isolated and entirely self-sufficient mountain ranch, and I've also amassed a good deal of gold, silver, and other currencies as a hedge against this scenario. Of course, I realize that most people can't do measures like these. So, in just a moment, I'm going to let you in on a couple of things I've put together to help you. But before I do, there's just one thing I haven't told you yet. All that I've just mentioned in this message is only Act One. You see, the story doesn't end with the shutdown of our credit networks and the massive systemic shock that comes along with it. What I've just warned you about is merely the run-up to an event that will change the course of world history and bring the American era to a shocking conclusion. Now, I know that you've already given me a lot of your time, and I appreciate that. So I won't go into the second part of this story right now, but I've laid it all out in The Great American Credit Collapse, a never-before-published exposé on this crisis. It's not that long, only 18 pages. You can read it fast and get ready quickly. And it's not some boring textbook on economics. It's written as a thrilling, easy-to-read account of what the future holds for America, what the collapse of our system will look like, and what the government will do in response. It details your day-to-day life in the post-credit economy. The shocking second act of this story that I haven't told you yet. The desperate policies our government will try and why they won't work. How food shortages will break out across the country, and where you should be when they hit. Where the money and the opportunities will be in the post-credit economy. Why I do not believe we're going into a 30-year depression, and much, much more. The fact of the matter is, the failure of our credit system won't just push down profits and produce a few layoffs. It will change everything about how you live in America and how you get around to the stores you shop at and the brands you buy. Now, I've written 2 New York Times bestsellers and about 5 books in total. You can go online and buy any of them. But I would recommend that you read The Great American Credit Collapse before anything else. Only you won't be able to find it on Amazon or at Barnes & Noble. In fact, I didn't even give it to my book publisher. That's because it's not for sale or intended to make me any profit. I have prepared The Great American Credit Collapse to be the definitive resource in understanding how this collapse will unfold. That's why you're about to get the opportunity to claim your own free copy in just a moment. It's the first step you can take right now to get protected. I've already put measures in place to protect myself and my family. In fact, let me show you what I've done. I'm currently writing this from my mountain cattle ranch, 9,247 feet above sea level, and a 6-hour trek from the nearest city. My laptop is running on solar power. And when the satellite I use to access the internet comes up over the mountain, I'll send this out to my offices back in Baltimore, where they're still recovering from riots earlier this year. It sounds odd, I know, and maybe I am a little eccentric, but I learned a long time ago that you can't just follow the crowd and do what everybody else does and hope to get different results. And actually, I don't live here full time. But it's nice to know I have a safe haven somewhere, especially as my 6 children get older and move away. I like knowing that they have a place to take shelter should the worst happen. We grow our own vegetables here. We keep our own livestock. In fact, here at the ranch, I even have a vineyard so I can drink my own wine. Meanwhile, to keep my money safe, I recommend that everyone have a stash of gold somewhere. And besides that, I personally keep my investments diversified in foreign currencies and foreign businesses. In fact, over the 30 years, I've tried to expand Agora as much as possible. Today, we have offices on every continent except Antarctica, in cities from Mumbai to Beijing to Paris and Baltimore. As far as I know, we're the only ones consistently and vociferously warning about this coming worldwide crisis. But I realize that you may not be able to take the same actions I've taken. And frankly, I wouldn't recommend that you do. Maintaining international properties when you're not around to fix things is very expensive. And I have an army of consultants, lawyers, advisors, and friends all over the world to make the connections and the investments I need to pull this off. But you don't have to. All the information and advice you need is available for free. You just have to connect the dots sometimes. Or you can let my team help you and make it simple. That is, I want to give you access to everything my team has pulled together on the end of credit in America. Consider it your personal intelligence briefing on the subject from the very head of a multinational research and news organization. And if you're imagining complex charts, data tables, and things that look like bank statements, don't worry. That's not at all what I have in mind. Let me show you what I mean. Let's start with where you can find money you can trust. The fact of the matter is, you should not trust money you can't hold in your hand. In the beginning of this crisis, before people realize what's going on, I expect physical dollars to become very scarce. Numbers on a screen will do you no good in a credit collapse. That's why if you ignore everything else from this presentation, I would hope that you maintain an emergency cash reserve at home, 1 month's worth of expenses at a minimum. But cash dollars aren't the only kind of money I would recommend you have during a crisis. Now, the truth is that I'm a bit of a gold bug. I've made good money investing in gold ever since issuing my trade of the decade back in the year 2000. Buy gold, sell U.S. stocks. In fact, I believe there is a very good possibility that the price of gold will rise dramatically. But please don't buy it to make money. It's also an excellent store of value, like an indestructible savings account. But gold is not actually that practical for day-to-day transactions once dollars become scarce and electronic forms of payment are no longer working. We saw this back in 2001 during Argentina's financial collapse. Argentines found themselves using radically different new forms of money. And the interesting part is that they weren't rare gems or coins. In fact, what becomes valuable in a crisis will shock you. Many times, it's stuff you already own in your own home, wealth you never thought you had. And there's often no one type of money that dominates in the aftermath of a major collapse. You may need different types of currency for different transactions. That's why I've had my team assemble a guide on the types of money you want to have readily available when our $60 trillion machine finally breaks down. For example, there's one small item you can buy at Walmart or almost any department store that during a crisis becomes an incredibly valuable currency for everyday goods. You may even have some in your home already. And there are plenty more examples. You'll find full details in The Crisis Money Guide, The Money You Need to Have in Times of Crisis. As part of your full briefing on our credit threat, I've decided to include this guide with every copy of The Great American Credit Collapse. And no, neither of these are for sale or available through any other Agora service. But that's just the beginning. Have you ever dreamed of having a safe, self-sufficient spot you can get away to? Imagine sitting down to a meal of your own meat and vegetables, never spending another second stuck in traffic on your way to Walmart. But having your own bolt hole with your own food supply is about more than just living better. When the credit system fails and shuts off our supply chain, I expect the cities and the suburbs to be hit hardest. They depend the most on shipped goods. That's why now is the time to look into getting a bolt hole, a hideaway. Call it a safe house. Don't worry, traveling to foreign countries is not required. According to my team of top researchers, there are still many ways to get beautiful property right here in the U.S., even on the cheap, and sometimes for free. In fact, some of the most beautiful land in America is up for grabs if you know where to look. You'll find it all in How to Get Your Own Bolt Hole on the Cheap. I actually used one of the techniques you'll read about to secure my very first building in Baltimore for just $1. But you don't have to move away from your home and your friends to take advantage of what I've done. In fact, when you receive your own copy of How to Get Your Own Bolt Hole on the Cheap, you'll discover what you can do to gain all of the advantages of having your own off-the-grid haven without ever leaving your own neighborhood and the friends you know so well. You see, being prepared is not just about hoarding money or moving out to the wild. There are many things you can do without taking such drastic steps. In fact, here's one of them. A little while ago, I went to find the best business to own when cash is tight, and credit is very hard to come by. I'm talking about the most profitable business in the worst of times. And no, this is not about taking advantage of anyone. In fact, this is a business that will come to the rescue of a lot of people who suddenly find themselves cut off from cash and credit. And the best part is that you don't have to wait till a crisis to take advantage of it. This is a business that can earn an annualized 243% right now. No, it's not some bank or financial wizard. It's about as underground as you can get. And you won't see this type of business getting any government bailouts. So they keep their risk ultra low. And when credit disappears in America, everyone will be a potential customer. It's all detailed in the next part of your briefing called The Best Business in the Worst of Times. Again, I don't offer an investing service. I do almost zero trading in my personal life. And when there is an opportunity I think has potential, I sometimes do share it. And that's exactly what I've done here. In fact, when I was asked to make one investment recommendation by our in-house private interview service, I gave them the name of just one company. The very same company you'll discover in your copy of The Best Business in the Worst of Times. As I write this, shares for this company are already in very positive territory, and I cannot guarantee it will still be a buy for much longer. I also cannot guarantee I will be issuing any further investment tips in the near future. So I urge you not to wait. Before discovering all the research I'm offering you today, including Great American Credit Collapse, The Crisis Money Guide, the money you need to have in times of crisis, How to Get Your Own Bolt Hole on the Cheap, The Best Business in the Worst of Times. And there's actually one more part. If you're thinking of moving when you retire, or are considering buying another home, then you won't want to miss The Smartest Move You Can Make in the Age of Dying Credit. It's a piece of advice that I think everyone should hear, especially if you're thinking about moving, selling your house, or buying another home. You'll receive it for free when you choose to find out the full story behind what's going on in America and how you can be prepared for it. But before I can give you access to this, I want to make sure that you really are getting filled in on every single crucial aspect of this developing story. That's why I'm including something a little bit different in the library you're about to receive. You see, part of the reason I've been observing this growing credit system for so long is that it has shocking similarities to other large-scale disasters I have observed in history. It shares a very important common thread with almost every single failure and disaster I've seen. But what's more intriguing is that the same thread pops up everywhere, even in places you'd least expect. It's a very simple phenomenon. It's been recorded by scientists, and yet most people don't realize it exists. That's astounding, because everything from the national debt and American credit to war to making money and getting rich to success in business, or how you interact and get along with other people, to almost any task we undertake, even your own projects and life's ambitions, deeply affected by this one thing. Had Napoleon understood this, his family might be still ruling half of Europe. If that seems incredible, it's precisely why I find this one thing so fascinating. It's everywhere. It's behind more than one specific form of cancer and many preventable diseases. It's behind mental health problems, too. If Americans understood it, we'd be leading much healthier, longer lives with much less government. It's so exceptional, I've actually written a book about it called Harmageddon. If I say so myself, it's the best book I've ever written. And it's probably the last book I'll ever write, because I consider it to be the final word on everything I've spent the last 40 years building. It's like the blueprint on which every prediction we've made and most of what I believe is based. And it has played a role in much of my life, just as it does in yours, even if you don't realize it. Of course, Harmageddon is not a self-help book. But it's almost impossible to truly understand what's about to happen to us without understanding what the word Harmageddon means. Here's what best-selling Black Swan author Nassim Nicholas Taleb and distinguished professor of risk engineering at New York University, had to say about Hormageddon. This is a must, must, must read. It is deep, illustrative, witty, pleasant to read. Buy two copies, one for yourself, another for the nearest policymaker. And contrarian economist Mark Faber, a.k.a. Dr. Doom, said, "I am seldom jealous of anybody, but I truly envy Bill Bonner's writing and intellectual skills. It's funny, cynical, sarcastic, highly informative, beautifully written, entertaining, and most importantly, written by a man who is not afraid to tell the truth and stand up for it. I do not say this often, but when I read this Hormageddon, I was truly in awe." I almost blush when I read reviews like that, but you might as well know what people are saying. Another reviewer says, "This is a book that works on so many levels. It's the kind of advice you wish your dad had given you." Another says, "Hormageddon is simply brilliant. This book offers a detailed analysis of the major problems of our day and exposes the fallacy that is collective central planning in a way that is undeniably logical. The true treasure contained within this book is not the microanalysis, however, but something even more important." You can buy a copy on Amazon, but just to make it easier, I've decided to include a free electronic copy of Hormageddon with the intelligence reports I've already mentioned. You see, I'm a businessman. Agora is not publicly funded, and we're independent of any bank or corporation or large media company. This is important. We're not saints or do-gooders. We're not smarter either. We're just not beholden to Wall Street or the government or big business. So we don't pretend not to see this huge credit bubble getting ready to pop. We're out here on our own. We owe all our success to individuals just like you, not Big Brother or big money. So you can see why I would want to tell you about what I believe to be the defining collapse of America. We're all in the same boat. And right now, I'm worried about what might happen to you and to other hardworking Americans when the credit market seize up and the ATMs stop working. So maybe it's time, before I let you go, to tell you what exactly is going to set off the largest financial collapse in world history. Well, the truth is that major events like this rarely have big triggers or flashpoints. For example, the Arab Spring, a revolution that toppled four governments, sparked civil wars, and led to mass protests and riots in at least 12 other countries, began when a fruit vendor set himself on fire. When the right set of conditions are all aligned, as they are right now in the U.S., it doesn't take a big event to set off a historic implosion. It's almost always something small, unexpected. Think about World War I, in which millions of Germans, British, and Americans died in trenches in France. It started with a shooting more than 1,000 miles away by a Bosnian. And if you're aware of what's going on in America today, if you've seen the unrest in our cities, if you've noticed that something's not quite right with our economy, then I don't think it will take much to set off an irreversible breakdown in our way of life. That's why I want to give you everything we've got on this crisis, because the most important thing I'm going to offer you is something I haven't even mentioned yet. It's a pass into a very special group within the largest independent multinational research firm in the world, Agora. Because this investigation isn't over yet. What we've uncovered so far is just the tip of the iceberg. This is what we do every day, try to connect the dots. So I don't want to leave you without offering you a way to stay in the loop about this growing threat and keep up to date with what's going on. It's like a passport into our world, one that's not governed by political correctness or the official line or partisan media networks. You see, the story of what comes next in our country, in economics, in our leaders, is far from over, and there's still plenty to discover. I've issued hundreds of financial reports over the last 40 years, yet this is the only one I've allowed to carry my name. I call it the Bill Bonner Letter. It's not an investing service, although I will occasionally cue my readers in to an actionable tip if I think it's worthwhile. It's definitely not a trading service or a self-help guide. I don't even get paid for doing it. That's because for me, the Bill Bonner letter is a personal project. But for you, it's a front row seat to some of the biggest economic changes of our time. This is a service for people who want more than what they see on cable television, who want to tune out all the guff we're constantly bombarded with and tune in to something fresh. It's for people who know there's another point of view out there, and they just need a way to tap into it. So far, the select group who received my letter have discovered how to invest in a world of negative interest rates, where to get a house on the pristine Mediterranean Sea for just 1 euro, no kidding. The very worst investments in the world today, including the story of a house in Florida selling for $139 million. And those are just some of the topics we've covered. There are a lot more. And here's what some of my readers have had to say. Fred M. writes,
"All I can say is the Bill Bonner letter isn't simply a breath of fresh air. It's a full-blown gale of it."
Subscriber Scott D. writes,
"Bill, incredible read this month. Very sobering, but I believe the truth. Very, very impressed with this first letter."
Subscriber Joe W. writes,
"While nothing is guaranteed, the future you present seems to be the logical conclusion to current macroeconomic trends. Bill does a great job of demonstrating this in a rational and humorous way."
Subscriber Rostislav S. writes,
"I feel that subscribing was a step in my life in the right direction. Not for profit, but for the wisdom Bill passes on to people who are interested. One of those people is me. Once again, thank you for that."
And subscriber Will H. writes,
"Bill and company, that was the best read I've had in a long time. It read like a preface to a world-class book that needs to be completed, as far as I'm concerned. Well said, well spoken. Excellent job. Now, please don't lose momentum and tear the established nonsense we've witnessed apart until the reality of it all is seen."
This is the first time I've ever opened up a service to share what I know with like-minded people. It's not something you'll find anywhere else. But fair warning, this is only available to serious people. Because I'm not about to give away a whole bunch of free stuff, no questions asked, or indulge any tire kickers. Right now, the sun is going down over the mountains, and I expect I'll lose satellite connection soon. If you've been waiting for me to make a recommendation about what you should do now, then here it is. Don't wait. Today, I'm inviting you to join the Bill Bonner letter and claim everything I've mentioned so far, including the Great American Credit Collapse, the Crisis Money Guide, the money you need to have in times of crisis, how to get your own bolt hole on the cheap, the best business in the worst of times, the smartest move you can make in the age of dying credit, and my last book, Hormageddon. You may have seen things like this sell for $500 or even $5,000, but I truly want to get this message out to as many people as possible. That's why the price for an all-access 12-month pass to the Bill Bonner letter is just $79. However, as a thank you for hearing me out, I want to give you a substantial discount, so I'm cutting that down to just $39. And you can try it at my risk. I will give you a full 90 days to try out everything you're about to get. And if you're not totally satisfied, if you are in any way underwhelmed, then you can just call in and get a full refund during that 90-day period. You risk nothing, and frankly, there's a lot to be gained. Just click the button below to get started. In the weeks that come, I expect the government will grow increasingly desperate in the Fed's battle against the fall of America's credit system. We've already seen how it is taking steps to limit your access to and use of cash. We've already seen how attempts to contain this problem have not worked. No nation has ever succeeded in cheating the natural laws of sound money, at least not for long. And the choices you make today will decide where you'll be on the day our dollars disappear, our banks shut down, and our way of life collapses. The risk is all on me. You'll have 90 days, that's 3 full months, to make a decision about whether this is for you. If you decide it's not, all you have to do is let us know. You'll receive 100% full refund. That's my guarantee. But the decision is yours. After all, it's your money, your life, your call. Please click below to get started immediately. By the way, in case you missed any of that, here's what you're getting today. 5 special intelligence reports on the state of our credit system and its impending collapse. The Great American Credit Collapse. The Crisis Money Guide, the money you need to have in times of crisis. How to get your own bolt hole on the cheap. The best business in the worst of times. The smartest move you can make in the age of dying credit. My book, Hormageddon, and a 12-month subscription to my ongoing investigation into America and the world, the Bill Bonner Letter. Plus, immediate access to every back issue and topic I've covered, all for $39, with a 90-day, 3-month full refund guarantee. Just click below to discover it all for yourself. P.S. A special gift for you and your family. When you click to subscribe, I'd also like to offer you a special gift in addition to everything else. It's totally free and something your whole family can enjoy. In fact, it's the type of thing you can share with your kids and grandkids and pass down to younger generations. Click below and see it for yourself. Thank you.